of the DSConf. My name is Akshat. So I just kickstart this conference with a bit of a background. So what started off as a meetup group about 1 year back by Nishant, Shripad, and the Ubay team has grown up to be a 1,000 community strong community now. And the conference is like an extension to the community. We have a distinguished panel here of speakers talking about a myriad of topics. The talks have been arranged in a manner with a lot of breaks in between to allow for discussions, Q&As, and geeking out. So without further ado, I'll introduce my first speaker here. His name is Dr. Sriram Srinivasan. He's a self-proclaimed geek with over 30 years of experience with a range of technologies right from machine level to application level. And he's here talking about the many flavors of consensus. Dr. Sriram, please.
Can you guys hear me? Excellent. So welcome. Thank you for sparing your precious weekend and your morning. And I hope to make it worth your while. So today I'm going to be talking about consensus and the variety of consensus. What is shown in this looping video here is this what is called a murmuration, a collection of starlings that sort of follow each other, right? And so here there is no, some of you who might have read about consensus protocols, there's no negotiation between where we are moving next. It's an emergent property here, right? Somehow the whole flock moves as one, but with very simple rules. And one of the ideas is that when we talk about consensus in English, you can say, no, you come to a consensus, you come to an agreement. But there is more to this thing. There's all kinds of varieties of what it means to have to come to an agreement. And I wish to explore a few of those, okay? And along, so as it turns out, as I was preparing this talk, it turns out that it, you know, this whole topic is sort of like pulling at spaghetti. You can't just get one, you'll just get many more tangled with it. And pretty soon you're like roped in all more than like 90% of distributed systems stuff. That's because it's basically distributed systems is all about consensus. Why is that? Basically you have two types of distributed systems where you need to have heterogeneous nodes talking to each other because they need to get something done together, right? If they didn't need to get something done together, they're not a system at all, they're just distributed. The very fact that they need to be in concert working on some problem together, they need to start talking to each other, and that means they need to come to a common decisions periodically about doing something, right? So they need consensus is at the very heart of getting a distributed system sticking, distributed system ticking. So heterogeneous nodes that have their own thing. So for example, you might have a database and you might have a queue, and you say both of these atomically, I need them to work. I need to put something in the database, I need to enqueue something, and either all of it happens or none of it happens. That is, they need to come to an agreement about, you know, these guys need to talk to each other and come to an agreement about this particular activity. Then there's a distributed system consensus amongst homogeneous nodes. And this is typically seen in fault tolerance. You have a kind of a node which is replicated n number of ways. It's homogeneous, it's the same kind of a thing. And you have a state machine that's replicated n number of ways. And you need some protocol to say that to keep all of these state machines in sync with each other. Okay, so these are consensus protocols as well. So consensus is basically at the heart of distributed systems. How many of you have read the literature of consensus protocols, some paxos and raft and terms like this? Okay, a few of about half of you, I guess. And many of you would have, you know, there are all these terms floating around, And the purpose of my talk here is not to go, I cannot possibly go into detail in everything. This is pretty much the entire curriculum of distributed systems, several course curriculum of distributed systems. But what I hope to do is to give you a historical context and how these things tie together. So on the left-hand side, you see synchronous approaches, and on the right-hand side, you see asynchronous approaches. And this is roughly the time frame in which developments happen. So I hope to talk about it in that particular order. So you know what led to what kind of thinking. Okay, so that context is clear. And I hope to touch upon a couple of things. So in terms of a real protocol, I'll probably talk about Raft and Bitcoin, okay, as a representative of all of this. But others, I'll just skip through at a high level. Okay. I talk fast normally, but in this talk, I'm going to be talking even faster because I have a lot of material to cover. Okay. So I beg your indulgence on that. So what is consensus? Let's just take a very simple example. You have a bunch of old and infirm and sickly people who might just copy it at any point. And they're going to have to discuss, come to a consensus, come to an agreement on a place for a reunion. Okay? So they need to decide on a place to meet up. And one approach is to say that everybody writes to everybody else saying, I prefer to meet in this place. Some X, okay? So A's preference is Goa, B's preference is Leh, and C's preference is Diu. And so everybody sends a message to everybody else. And the pre-agreed protocol is that we select the smallest alphabetically the smallest name that everybody hears about, okay? So everybody will end up selecting Diu because that is the alphabetically smallest thing, okay? So they have come to an agreement. So when they've received the messages, they each take a local decision, right? There's no further negotiation. Having received the messages, at some point, they take a local decision by themselves and say, okay, I'm booking my tickets now. Now, whatever scheme you choose should have the property that having booked the tickets, I should not find out tomorrow that this fellow is going somewhere else and I'm going somewhere else, right? It has to be a unanimous decision. Now, consensus, the various flavors of consensus, in this case, in this particular case, we are looking for a unanimous decision. We will see others where you'll have a majority consensus. Okay. In this case, we are looking for a unanimous consensus. But the question now is there a unanimous decision at the end of the day with this given the scheme? And the answer is obviously not, because anybody can keel over and die. And so let's say C dies. He sends a message to A, but is unable to send a message to B. So A hears from all of them, right? But B hears only from A, so Leh and Go are the options available to him. And for A, all three options are available to him because he's heard from everybody else. Now, at the end of day one, if he takes an independent decision, one guy will book his ticket for Delhi, another guy is going to book his ticket for Leh. So clearly, this scheme is not enough, or stopping at day one is not enough. So now the question comes, do I proceed? Do I keep doing the same thing? Or does everybody keep saying the same, giving their preference to everybody else? Should that be the scheme? An alternative scheme could be this. Everybody writes to everyone, this is what I have heard so far. So it's not just my stuff. If I hear about somebody else, I'm going to talk about them also. So at the end of the first day, this guy has heard of DLG, the same scheme. This guy has heard of only LG. And this guy, of course, is dead, is not in a position to hear anything. So at the end of the day one, it's like this. And the algorithm also says, stop when there's no changes to your own list. So this is an individual instruction. Everybody is following the same instructions independently, okay? Independently, they're taking their own things. And the instruction says, stop when there's no change to list. So A started off with just Goa, and then the list, his own list changed to Delhi, Leh, Goa. Whereas for B, it changed to this thing. So of course, there's no question of stopping anymore. So they repeat this round again, okay? So they again send messages to everybody else saying, this is what I've heard from everybody else so far, okay? So this guy sends LG to here, and he assimilates it here. And he sends LG to here, but that message is wasted. Meanwhile, this fellow sells DLG to this guy, so this guy's list changes. So he's going to go for one more round. Okay? But at this point, he can realize, if he knows the size of the membership, he knows there are only 3 members to begin with, he has as much information as he can possibly get, he can stop. He doesn't have to send any more. They are maxed out. So even though this fellow is dead, his choice is alive because he heard it through the grapevines through some other means. Right? And in this consensus protocol, the idea is that they will take anybody's proposal, even if they're living or not. Because there are all equally valued proposals, we just need to settle on one. That is the only constraint. Okay? So at the end of day 2, they know independently it's time to stop any further messaging. I can make the decision now. Independently, they can make this decision. Right? In fact, this guy can make the decision right here. Because he knows there are only 3 people. He can make the decision, but he cannot stop until, you know, he has heard from everybody else. Because he doesn't know if somebody else is unsure. Okay? But he can book his tickets right here. Whereas this guy has to wait until day 2 to book his tickets. Okay? So this is a very simple agreement protocol. And the characteristics of this problem statement, and the reason I'm talking about characteristics is that there are so many flavors of, there are so many varieties of consensus only because the types of problems that they cover are very different from each other. So the types of solutions are very different as well. Okay? So in this particular case, you have what is called synchronous messaging. There is a clock, there is a notion of a day. The sun is your clock. At the end of every day, you have a decision to make. Okay? One of the things that I did not mention here is that the mail system that I have assumed here, which is an implicit thing, that mail never gets lost. Only people die, but mail doesn't get lost. It's guaranteed delivery at the end of the day. Okay? That's an implicit thing that I have, belief that I have. Okay? So because it's synchronous messaging, okay, at the end of the day, if for a day, if I have not heard from somebody, I know he's dead. Because if he had posted a letter, it's guaranteed delivery, so I would have heard from him. Right? If I have not heard from a person, he's gone. So in a synchronous system where there is a definite time bound to any activity, right? There's an upper bound to the speed of, I mean, the amount of time a particular task takes, decision time or whatever, writing to disk or whatever, or the amount of time a network message takes, there's a bounded time in which a message is delivered. That's a synchronous network, which means that it is useful to have a timeout and say, okay, since I have not heard back for this time, I can take this decision. So silence is meaningful in a synchronous system, okay? Which is why I can sit here and I can imagine that somebody with a synchronized clock, and I can imagine that somebody at the US might be, I can say, he must have woken up by now, without communication, right? Because synchronous, there is a lot of information in synchronous activities, which is why designing for synchronous systems is very easy. Once you are given a synchronous, once you are given this guaranteed messaging base, it's very easy to program it. Consensus is easy. In this case, the other assumption is that participants stay crashed. Once they die, they die. They're not like Rip Van Winkle's, they wake up 20 years later and say, okay, I'm ready to join the party. No, you can't do that. And in this case, membership is fixed. Right? There's only a fixed number of members, and that is useful information. Unlike, for example, Bitcoin, you don't know how many members there are. Right? So that is a completely different problem set, completely different solution. Okay, so this is the characteristic of the problem statement. And for this particular solution, this is order n squared messages, roughly quadratic number of messages that are exchanged between participants. And the guarantee is that, given this last solution, that if there were d deaths before the decision was taken, it will take at most d plus 1 days before everybody, the survivors, have converged to a unique decision. Okay? And finally, the decision that is taken is a purely local one. I mean, at some point, on some day, this guy says, okay, I have enough information now. There's no more information that's forthcoming that's going to change my mind. This is it. I'm going to make my decision. It's a purely local decision. At that point, I can't say, book karunga ticket. No, that doesn't work. Okay, the final decision has to be local. This is the characteristics of this solution. The characteristics of all consensus solutions take this format. All consensus solutions, regardless of the type of problem, there are certain commonalities to all consensus problems and solutions. There are three important properties, so I'll call them VAT properties: validity, agreement, and termination. Validity basically says that, you know, everybody has a proposal. The final decision that is taken has to be one of those proposals. Now, this seems like a trivial point to make, but it takes care of a lot of edge conditions, okay? I will not belabor that point anymore. Agreement, which is fairly obvious, basically we all agreed on a particular place to go to, okay? There's unanimity in this particular agreement. In some cases, there is majority agreement, right? That's the terms and conditions of that particular agreement protocol. But the important thing about agreement is that at the end of it, there should not be any disagreement, okay? And third and very important point is termination, which means that you should not take forever to decide. At some point, your protocol should be that you don't go off into an infinite loop, that you remain undecided forever. It should terminate. And we'll look at a particular important example of a case where it doesn't terminate, okay? Even though it looks like agreement, it is not. I mean, even though it looks like consensus, it is not. That's one of the characteristics that's an important prerequisite for any consensus solution. And you will find that in all solutions, they end up using these set of functions that are monotonic, idempotent, commutative, associative functions. Okay? These are a handful, so I'll go through it. And how many of you here have heard of CRDTs? Okay, a fair number. Well, CRDTs use the same concept, but this is a very, very, very useful concept in all of computer science. Okay, it's used in compiler analysis, it's used in distributed systems, it's used all over the place. Okay, the idea of, so the examples are set, union, max, and min. Okay, the idea is this. In our example, what we used was a set. This is a set of replies or a set of places that I have accumulated. That is my, for each participant, that's the state that they have accumulated. Okay? It's a set of likely places to go to. And it might change the moment that set stops growing, then you know it's time to make a decision. Okay? That's our algorithm. And the reason it has these properties, it's monotonic basically means that information cannot be taken out, cannot be deleted. It can only grow. So in the case, suppose you have a state that is a set, some information comes in, it gets absorbed into it, it basically gets unioned into it, so set can only grow. By using union as an operator, you are only absorbing and gaining knowledge. You're not dropping knowledge, okay? With max as well. So if I have a number and a new number comes in, I take the max up my thing. A new number comes in, either it is higher than what I already have, in which case I up my max, but I never go down, right? The number keeps on increasing. So this is monotonically increasing. Monotone means in a singular direction, okay? Idempotent, if the same event comes to me again, it's not going to change my state. So I have a set, if the same place comes back again, it's already in my set, a union is not going to change that. It's commutative and associative because order does not matter. It doesn't matter in which order it got unioned because set is basically an orderless collection, right? Order-free collection. So you will see the use of these set, union, and maxes and minimums all over consensus algorithms. And these are the keys. This is the key for coming to a consensus. You never drop information. You always accumulate information until you have such sufficient information that there comes a point where you can take a decision. Okay, I was thinking of something I forgot. Anyway, moving on. These are the problem spaces that consensus is applied to, and this is basically goes everything from embedded electronics in aircraft to databases to Bitcoin to shared data structures in memory, right? Even if you have multiple processors, they are basically distributed system. On a, you know, even if it's multi-core, it's a distributed system on a chip. You have the same problems everywhere. Clock synchronization. Right? So in this particular example that we had, we assumed that there is a clock in the system. But the fact that there are two units that are agreeing to the same time, that itself is a consensus problem. Because they have to agree to the fact that they are in the same time. So in some sense, you have pushed the consensus problem to the clock, to the underlying network infrastructure. Okay. And in biology, you will see a lot of emergent consensus, like honeybee swarms, you know, shoals of fish that move as if like a big thing, or starlings that move together. Right? There are very, very different assumptions in problems. I am going to be spending time on the top three, avionics, databases, and Bitcoin. And hopefully, I'll have some time to go through all of it. Okay. So the first example that comes, so now we are going to be talking about synchronous systems. Okay, just starting with the earlier, keeping with the earlier example, which was a synchronous system that was like a sort of a drum beat as the clock. Here's a paper from October 1978, which was called SIFT, which is Software Implemented Fault Tolerance. So fault tolerance was at one time for avionics. Fault tolerance was implemented in hardware. These guys wanted to move all of it into software in order to take a voting, a majority decision. So because there are many sensors that are flaky or get shot at during the war and stuff like that, so they wanted to have, you know, multiple units of everything, right? And so you have multiple CPU units, processor units, you have multiple bus controllers, multiple buses, and so on. Okay, they're all like massively redundant, massively cross-wired to interconnected to each other. And they're synchronous processors and synchronous messaging, which means, for example, every 100 milliseconds, there'll be a message out, regardless of whether you have something useful to say or not. So there is like a steady drum beat, okay? And all tasks take less than 50 milliseconds. So you know that whatever task is given, it has to fit within that interval. Everything has a time bound. But in a twist to the earlier people getting to their problem, here you have processors don't just crash. They start misbehaving because of electronic issues, okay? And it so happens that in electronics, these kinds of things happen all the time. It's way more common than one gives credit to. And it's kudos to hardware designers that we, you know, we stay afloat in the sky. And now the problem is, there are some processors that are acting, you know, they're acting freakily. They are misrepresenting others. So in this example where we said, no, everyone can report what they have heard so far, there can be processors that say, this is what I've heard. I heard X, and I tell this to this guy, and I heard Y to this guy. Right? I'm completely misrepresenting. I'm giving different answers to different people, and also misrepresenting what other guy told me. In the face of this constraint, how do you have an agreement problem? I mean, how do you have agreement between all the non-faulty processors? That's the problem. Right? The solution was given in this, but it was taken out as a pure model out of the avionics framework. It was taken out as a pure model in this follow-on paper, which was basically a companion paper by Shostak and Pease and Lamport. It's called Reaching Agreement in the Presence of Faults. Okay? And the problem statement here says it's synchronous things, it's synchronous network, the links are reliable, but the processors can be weird. Okay, they can do pretty much, they have no control, but they have a certain number of faults. And they came up with an impossibility results. It's a very celebrated paper. They came up with an impossibility results that in order to get any consensus at all, you need to have a two-thirds majority. Okay, you need to have a two-thirds majority to get any consensus out of it. So if you have a bunch of redundant processors, some of which, and you don't know which, are acting flaky, and you treat that entire set of processors as one black box, and you want a decision out of it saying, okay, tell me what my current height is. What does the altimeter say? And there are n altimeters, there are n processors. Finally, you come to a consensus and tell me what is my current height. You need one answer, right? I don't care if you do majority, whatever you do. And this particular thing is an impossibility result says that there can be no algorithm that can possibly get consensus if you don't have a two-thirds majority. Right? It doesn't matter how smart you are. You cannot come up with an algorithm. It's an impossibility result. You need a two-thirds majority in this particular case. But they also go on to say that if the messages are signed, then impersonation cannot be done. right? If I hear from somebody and I tamper with that message and forward it to somebody else, that other processor can discover that you've tampered with it. Then you can discard the message. If the message has been signed, cryptographically signed, right? It doesn't have to be cryptographically signed, but it just needs to be signed with a CRC or whatever, okay? So in that case, a simple majority voting is sufficient in this particular example, right? With synchronous messaging and everything. Now, you basically take off from, so there was a follow-on paper to this paper because Lamport came up with a more, with a simpler proof, or what he calls simpler proof, which was the Byzantine generals problem. How many of you here have heard of this term, Byzantine generals? Oh, yeah. So clearly the Bitcoin stuff has gone around, so everybody talks about Byzantine generals. But it turns out, so if you, it mildly bothers me that this is quoted in the context of Bitcoin, because Bitcoin is the entire antithesis of this kind of a problem domain. It is asynchronous, they have no hold over membership. The only thing that seems to be common is that nodes are not to be trusted, right? But there is no synchronicity at all. There's messages can be lost. There's all kinds of stuff. It's completely different, right? So the one takeaway from this thing is that when you apply a term, be mindful of the context in which it was created, okay? There is this thing that somebody, James Mickens, wrote. I'm going to skip over it, but it will be there in the slides. And if you have not heard James Mickens, you owe it to yourself. He's a hilarious fellow. I don't want to dwell on it too much for lack of time. These slides will be available on the YouTube link. We'll put it up along with handouts, like the handout notes. So don't worry about slides being skipped, okay? So it's basically the same problem as before. They just reformulated the problem in a more story-like fashion. And they said that instead of processors acting in different ways, they talked about generals coordinating with each other to launch an attack. And only if they can reach a consensus on whether they can attack, then it's worthwhile. Otherwise, if one of them goes into war, they're going to get slaughtered. Okay? So they need to get a majority. But they're also mindful of the fact that somebody could be a traitor. So suppose you have three generals, and unbeknownst to B, this fellow is a traitor. A says attack, and A says attack to this guy, but C misrepresents A, and he says, he said retreat. So as far as B is concerned, he's getting two messages, attack and retreat. Okay. Look at this example, where A is a traitor, so he gives one message to one guy and another message to another guy. Right? This guy faithfully repeats it, but from the point of view of B, there is no difference. He's getting a message attack, and he's getting a message retreat from here. There is no way for him to tell which one is the traitor. Okay? And the result basically says that three generals are not enough in this particular synchronous situation. Okay? You need at least four in order to solve a one traitor problem. If you have two traitors, then you need 3F plus 1. There is just seven generals. Okay, if you have two traitors. So basically it's 3F plus 1, where F is the number of traitors. You have an upper bound of the number of traitors, and then 3F plus 1, so that you have two-thirds majority. Okay? That was about synchronous systems. So now we're going to move into asynchrony, where you don't have a global clock. And this has been this typical case for databases. You have multiple computers. They are not bound together by a common clock, or the clocks cannot really be trusted. The first problem that people faced, and they had a solution for it in 1972, and Jim Gray talks about two-phase commit and stuff like that with reference to this 1972 work inside of IBM. It was never published. But basically, it is transactional stuff. I'm assuming that all of you understand two-phase commit, right? So I'll just skip over it. But I want to, the solution for atomic commit is basically two-phase commit, right? I want to focus on one particular property of two-phase commit. Now here, the agreement problem is you have a bunch of things that need to go to commit, and the agreement is whether it's a go, no-go decision. That's what the coordinator is for. The coordinator is going to drive consensus. He's going to get all of the people and say, okay, Are you ready? If you're not ready, then if you're all ready, then let's commit. Okay, that's, it's in two phases. Okay. Now, from the point of view of the database, when it gets a prepare message, and it, once it has responded, it enters a period of doubt. That period of doubt is it cannot take any autonomous decision on which way to go. Basically, what the message that it has come is, are you prepared to commit? Okay? And when it says yes, basically what it's, its stance is I am prepared to go either way. If you tell me to commit, I'll commit. If you tell me to abort, I'll abort. But it's waiting on instructions from the coordinator. But if the coordinator dies, you basically are going to wait. They cannot take any independent decision. He's stuck. So he's stuck on somebody else's progress. So you can imagine, possibly, that there is an alternative protocol where this guy says, okay, if the I'm not hearing from the coordinator, maybe I'll go check with all the other databases. Maybe there's a way I've heard about all the other databases. Let me go check with them, what did you hear from about this status? But what if there was another database that is also down? So one of the participants is down. Maybe the coordinator already said commit to that guy and both of them went down. Or maybe he said abort to that guy and both of them went down. The others have not heard about anything. Now they cannot take an independent decision. Right? They are all stuck. So this is an example of a blocking protocol. One participant's progress is stalled because another participant is down. Right? This flies in the face of fault tolerance. Because if one guy is faulty, it basically ends up messing everybody else. You want independence. You want fault independence. Right? That is the essential property. So effectively, two-phase commit is not really a consensus protocol. If everything is okay, it allows in agreement. Right? But it cannot drive itself to independently drive itself to completion. Right? Other people cannot talk to each other and come to an independent decision. So it's a blocking protocol. So there's no termination guarantee. How many of you here have heard of the FLP paper? OK, good. Very few of you, so I have some reason to be talking here. So there came a point in the when people are using, you know, in distributed systems, they would use timeouts liberally and almost always, you know, get it wrong. If you have too short a timeout, then you're timing out too early and making decisions about something where it's technically not true. Okay, maybe the message is on the way and you timed out too early and took a decision and it was just too premature. Or you waited too long and, you know, it, everything is shot to pieces. So the thinking was, can we just not rely on timeouts at all to make a decision? Is it possible to come to a consensus without having, without relying on the fact that anything could have a time bound? Let's say things don't, let's say I don't get answers on time. Can we still make progress? And this impossibility paper by Fisher, Lynch, and Patterson, which is why it's called the FLP result, it basically showed a very elegant way where it says that it's impossible to get consensus with the specter, with one faulty process. Basically, it says that if it were, if you are given, now we have moved to asynchrony, okay? There is no time bound on when messages can come. And in this situation, if network is asynchronous and messages can be delayed, but processes are deterministic and can they crash and they don't come up, okay? In this case, they showed that even if the process doesn't crash, but there is a possibility of a process crashing, you cannot achieve consensus. There cannot be any consensus protocol. Basically, that means that you cannot have a protocol that can terminate. You cannot have a result in some bounded time. It's possible that fate is such that, you know, it delays the message just so that you are on the verge of taking a decision and some other message says, you're back to square one and you can't take a decision. And they show a constructive way to say that you could be in this period of doubt indefinitely. So you can never take a decision. Okay? So you can have a consensus protocol, but you can never give a guarantee of termination. So this was the result, but it turns out, unlike the halting problem in computer science, this is, turns out it's not as crippling in practice as they, it, it's shown to be, because there's randomization. We are talking about deterministic state machines, but if you introduce a bit of randomness, you know, consensus emerges. right? It sooner happens sooner in practice than you imagine. And networks tend to recover. It's not like, you know, they willfully hold back messages. Networks, the partitions heal, they tend to recover. And so in practice, if you write a consensus algorithm, it'll work just fine. Don't just expect a guarantee, because there will be oddball cases where it's just stuck for a long time. On the whims, you know, you're resting on the whims of the network, so you're stuck. Okay? So the way to frame this property, all the properties of the safety, all the properties of a consensus algorithm, is you frame it in terms of safety and liveness. By safety and liveness, it means that safety says that it must ensure that the algorithm does nothing bad. So take an example of traffic lights. Suppose you have traffic lights responsible for each direction, okay? And they have to come to a consensus saying, okay, this one is, this side is green, so this guy is red, and or vice versa, okay? They need to come to this agreement. Now, safety basically means that it's perfectly fine if all lights are red. There will be no traffic accidents. But it's not live, nobody is moving, okay? In order for liveness to happen, it must eventually do something good. It is not permitted to have all lights green. That is unsafe. That breaks the invariant, okay? So in this particular example, traffic light, the consensus property says that at no point should all four lights be green. It's perfectly okay if all four lights are red. But hopefully, only for a short amount of time, and when that period of uncertainty goes away, then you're back to getting consensus. Back to getting useful work done. Okay? So, by the end of the 80s, there were a whole set of celebrated consensus algorithms. There was the very famous Paxos paper. How many of you have heard of Paxos? Okay, a fair number of you. Okay? Paxos became famous because Google used it and made, you know, there is a paper called Chubby. You look up the Chubby lock service, and they talk about using Paxos in it. So this algorithm became quite famous. But for the longest time, this was buried. It was hidden in academia because people could not make head or tail of this thing. And it sort of started a cottage industry of people trying to explain this paper. Right? So there are like tens of papers were published trying to explain this particular paper. And so putting it in practice was really hard. Getting it right was really hard in practice. I feel that these other two papers, they were different algorithms. But eventually, you can see that there are parallels to each other. They also achieve consensus in asynchronous networks. And one is called view-stamped replication, a new primary copy method to support highly available distributed systems. This is by Barbara Leskov, also another Turing Award winner. And Ken Berman's work from the Cornell group. Some of you might have heard of this product called ISIS. That is a long time ago. That came out of this group. Well, not the ISIS that we know of now, but after the Greek god. But exploiting virtual synchrony in distributed systems. So these two papers, I feel, are not given as much patta as they ought to be. In fact, if you look at Raft consensus protocol, it actually takes off after this one. It's very, very similar to view-stamped replication. Okay. So these are consensus protocols. But going by the FLP result, they provide you safety. So if they come to a consensus, it'll be uniform consensus, right? Or you will have consensus. But there's no guarantee that under all network conditions, you will get consensus, okay? Because the liveness property, because of FLP impossibility, there's no guarantee. But in practice, these work just fine. Okay, so I'm not going to be talking about any of these. I'm going to be talking about Raft, which was a later protocol that came up. So I just want to talk about APIs. So let's assume this is the user space. And let's say all the consensus code has been stuck into its own layer. So each sort of process has its own local consensus component. And so you're interacting with the local consensus component. And those elements of that layer talk to each other to come to a consensus. So in the case of our people writing letters to each other, instead of writing letters to each other, what they would do is they would propose their place, their choice, to this API. And then these things talk to each other follow some protocol, send a flurry of messages back and forth for some time. And then when a decision comes at some point saying, OK, we have decided, this is the decision, this guy can fearlessly go ahead and say, OK, the decision has been made. OK, this is a black box. And many consensus protocols are described with this kind of a format, where you have a single value that is proposed by every participant, and a decision is made on behalf. One of those values pops up as the final decision from the consensus layer. Okay, that is the API that is given. This is typically in the theory literature. In the practice literature, which is what I favor more, so view stamped replication and Ken Berman's view synchrony paper, they were more, because they had also developed systems along with the theory, they followed this approach. So there are two kinds of APIs which are sort of congruent to each other. One is a shared log abstraction. And so internally, so outside, you have this view. You have your user might be like a state machine, okay? And the view you have of the consensus layer is of an infinite log to which you can only append, okay? What this does is that if you get many, many events into the state machine, like some clients, let's say, suppose this is a key value store and this is a key value store. This is a replica of the store and this is a replica of the store. So you want the replicas to be in sync with the main one. Okay? Suppose this guy is handling all the clients. Okay? So then he proposes this. He says, append to this log. And these guys, this layer talks to each other and says, okay, we have appended. And that time there's a guarantee that whatever I've said to append has now been appended, okay? But the nice thing about this abstraction is that it gives you an array abstraction, which means that it takes care of ordering, okay? So if one event comes before another event in this particular array, it'll come in exactly the same slots in the other array on the other machine. So this makes state machine replication very, very simple. You have a state machine, you start at a particular state, and you walk through, you apply each of these operations that are sitting inside each of these slots, right? These are the events. And the state machine evolves to a later state. The same thing can be replayed here as well, because the array looks the same, the initial state is the same, so the final state will be the same in all places. Okay? So this mechanism is a very, very nice mechanism to do state machine replication, having a shared log. And you will see the usage of a log everywhere in computer science. We know, for example, Postgres has log shipping. So they have a database write-ahead log. If you want to do replication, they just say, oh, here, take this log. And there you have. You know, you just take this file, and they can replay it. And now they have a copy of the, they can rebuild the database there. Okay? You have logs in Kafka. It's exactly the same principle. Here's an immutable log which can only be appended at the end. You cannot change anything in between. And so by the fact that it's immutable, if it is there at a particular position, we all have an agreement that if I go to a particular location, all of us can see the same thing. Okay? Shared log is a wonderful abstraction to have. So now you can have, for example, this state machine manage any kind of data structure. It doesn't have to be a hash table. It could be a B-tree. It could be anything. It could be sets. It doesn't matter. Whatever operation comes here, it plays it back one by one according to serial order, and it evolves. And so you have a replicated data structure without any customization of the consensus layer. Okay? The second API is atomic broadcast, which basically says, which is the kind of thing Zookeeper does. And they have a Zookeeper atomic broadcast protocol. And this takes after Ken Berman's work, where the primitive is also of like a stream. And they say, broadcast this for me to everybody, okay? And everybody gets back a call back saying a message that will be delivered, okay? Deliver is a message that is an up call. And what that means is that if there were multiple, if many of these guys did an atomic broadcast simultaneously, okay? The system will make sure that all the deliveries are done in the same order at all machines. And if it's not delivered, if it's not ready for delivery on one machine, it's not ready for delivery on another machine either. If it's ready for delivery on one machine, that means consensus has been achieved in the order. So you have not only have consensus about the values, you also have consensus about the order in which values are going to be presented to the layer above. So it's essentially the same stream is visible on all state machines. Okay? So again, you can do state machine replication. So you can write the shared log abstraction in terms of this, or you can write a broadcast primitive in terms of a shared log abstraction. They're completely congruent to each other. It doesn't matter. I'm going to take a concrete look at one of these consensus algorithms. And it says, in search of an understandable consensus algorithm, this was a Usenix paper in 2014. And these guys got really frustrated trying to read the Paxos papers and not making head or tail of it. And so they decided to say, no, let's try to understand what this is. And finally, they wrote their own, right? And this one, remarkably, is geared towards education, right? So how understandable is it? And typically, you see algorithms that are designed for efficiency. But here you have, not only do you have efficiency, but it's also presented in a way that is understandable. So if you're going to do any distributed systems work at all hands-on, I urge you to read this paper and try to implement it. And you, pretty much all the stuff that I talked about will just be plain to you. So here it goes. So Raft has this notion of a leader, a primary, which is going to broadcast to its secondaries. The secondaries are called followers. So they have leaders and you have followers. Now, you'll have a question automatically. It says that who decided leader? Well, that itself is a consensus problem. A bunch of myself might think this guy's a leader. A bunch of others might think this guy's a leader. So you're solving a consensus problem using some kind of already solved consensus problem. That seems weirdly incestuous. So we'll hold off that point until I come to it. The next is, but let's assume for the time being that we have a single leader, okay? And let's say you have multiple requests coming in from clients, and they are sent to the primary, okay? Now, each of these things already have one entry in the zeroth index, okay? Now, there is a notion called a term that's in the Raft literature. What this basically means is that you don't say A is a leader. A at term 2 is a leader. It's sort of like saying Indira Gandhi was the prime minister from 66 to 77, and then she was the prime minister from 80 to 84. Right? Two different terms of leadership. In between, Indira Gandhi was not a leader. Right? So you don't associate leadership with nodes. You associate leadership with node and term. So for this particular term, for term number 2, A is the leader. Okay? So how we got to that point, I'll talk about. I have not talked about leadership election yet. But for the moment, let's assume that this is the case. And let's assume that this guy dictates all the terms, no pun intended. He's going to say, do this. He's going to basically tell everybody, and the followers are going to blindly follow. Okay? Well, not quite blindly follow. I'll just come to that. So there are two requests that are incoming. So the first thing that this guy does is put those two in some order. He takes a decision to say, this one goes into slot 2, this goes into slot 3. And he makes an annotation saying, this particular slot was entered by the leader at term 2, this particular slot was done by leader at term 2. Basically, this means that this brown slot, there must have been, in earlier history, there must have been a leader at term 1 who said, do this. Okay? That has come and gone. That guy's crashed. Somebody else got elected. He's at term 2 now. And he says, do this for me. I'm going to enter into my log, and I'm going to send an RPC call to the others, saying, you do the same. You append it to your log as well. So the things that he says is, this is my term currently. This is the contents. These are the two data items that I want you to append to your log. And the last item on my log looks like this. It is, I don't send the value. I just say that the index is 0. The last item is at index 0. And the term of that is this term 1. Okay? These are the two numbers that I send. Okay? The follower, for its part, when it receives a message, says, okay, yeah, my situation is the same. I also have at the zeroth index, I have an entry by term one. So it looks like what you have, it looks like your log, so it's safe to append. Because if it was blindly appending, in case our states have diverged, I'm appending to some log and you're appending to some log, that doesn't work. So it does a check saying, okay, if you have this, then I'll append. It's like a compare and append primitive, atomically. Okay? If my, so this guy basically is saying, if your log looks like this, then do so. And this guy says, yes, it does look like this. So he's going to append to his log, okay, and return okay. Okay? Now at this point, this guy has, these two people have, they are followers, they have temporarily installed these entries. They are not available to the state machine yet. Why is that? Because these guys don't know whether that, you know, after sending this message to this guy, if he crashed, then only this fellow has those entries. Nobody else has those entries. He can't possibly give it to the state machine and have it diverge from the rest, right? Because you can't back up. So you want to be doubly sure that this thing is now firmly stable on all machines before he can dare give it to the layer above, because it's a consensus issue. The consensus here is that everybody has the same stable entries. So this is still work in progress, okay? When the okay comes to the leader, and it comes back from a majority of participants, then the leader says, okay, now I can rest in peace. If I die or somebody else dies, there is still a majority of people, there is still somebody who's surviving who has this data, okay? I'll leave the final details for you to read the paper, but he basically sends out a message saying, okay, now it's ready to make this stable. He sends out a commit message. He says, until index 2, commit it, which basically means make it pakka, okay? So this message indicates to this guy, the very fact that this guy has set a commit means that the leader has heard back from a majority, that's the reason he's sending me commit, okay? So this is stable now. Now these three entries are now available in that order to their respective state machines. Okay, this is normal operation. What happens if, you know, a message doesn't reach, like let's say A is unable to talk to B, or maybe A has crashed? What happens? So the system then goes into a, well, not the system, but there's a leadership election that started. So this one, says he stands up as becomes a candidate, says vote for me, right? He basically times out, and they can time out at any point. For no rhyme or reason, they can time out. No problem at all. Even if they've been hearing, the system is stable, is the whole system is safe. The invariant is that anything that is committed will never be backed out. It's immutable. And the invariant is that if it is committed, it's committed elsewhere also. Okay, that is safe. So that property will never be compromised. Okay, you may not be able to make progress. That's a different thing. Because all these netas are getting in the way. But safety will never be compromised. So this guy stands for election and says, you know, I have not heard from A for a long time. Okay, I'm time out. I'm going to become a candidate. So from follower, he becomes a candidate state. And he sends out a message saying, vote for me. And my term, he's now incremented his term. It was a 2. So he says, I'm going to increment my term to 3. And he says, my term is 3. And the last item in my log is at index 2, and its term is 2. Okay? It's information about my log. And anybody who's going to, so and the first thing he does is vote for himself, right? And then he sends out this message. And the invariant is that you, the principle is that if you already voted for somebody for a given term, then you don't vote for anybody else again, right? So in a particular term, if you've already voted once for an election, then you don't vote again for that election, right? Then you wait it out for the next leadership thing. It's just like politics. So, in this case, vote for me. So he sends it out, and if he gets back an okay from multiple, from a majority of followers, then he knows that for that particular term, a majority has now accepts me as a leader, so he crowns himself the leader. Meanwhile, this guy, when he has received a message of a higher term, right, he was a 2, and this was term 3, he says, oh, somebody has now gone ahead, I should step down now, upgrade to that guy's term. So basically, I'm a follower of term 3 now. I'll take my marching orders from B now. Okay? So next time if a client comes and if A is contacted, A will send them, redirect them to B saying now he's the leader and let him do all the needful. Okay? So this, if you see this, this is actually a distributed system. But this mechanism that we have chosen is actually a centralized one. We have chosen leader, and the leader is making all the decisions. They are not like sending messages to each other and decentralized, unlike in our first example. There was no leader there, right? They were just sending messages. Each was sending messages to everybody. But the problem there is that it becomes very inefficient. This way, when everything is channelized through one leader, he lays out the order in his own array. He lays out the order and says, just append it in this order, everybody. Okay? So the only confusion happens when there are multiple leaders that show up. Suppose there are two leaders that show up. They both time out independently, both stand for election. But the guarantee is that only one can win the election because it takes a majority to win an election for a given term, right? So if both of them start with term 3 and start out sending messages, finally there can be only one majority at most, right? By definition of majority, there can be only one majority and one of them is bound to win. But it is quite possible that you end up splitting the vote and nobody has a majority. That's very much possible. So then they basically go back to being a follower, restart their timer, and a randomized timer, and nobody makes any progress because nobody is a leader anymore. Presumably because it's a random timer, one of them will time out first and hopefully he'll win the election. Okay? So by judicious use of randomization, you are making progress. Right? The progress is there because you have a leader. You have a question? Yeah, so we have 2 minutes. So I'll have time for questions at chai. I don't want to hold back everyone for chai. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So maybe I will ask later or now I can ask.
Let's, why don't I just go through my material right now, if you don't mind. And then we'll see, maybe we can just sort of combine this with this question answer with chai or whatever, because I don't want to get in the way of, there's only so much consensus stuff a brain is equipped to take. So let's just review what the landscape that we have so far. We have done embedded systems, avionics, okay? This is all synchronous. Then we've done data storage systems, databases, and various kinds of asynchronous consensus protocols, culminating in raft. All this time, until fairly recently, the basic thinking in distributed systems was we cannot have synchronous clocks. And so we have to think in terms of asynchrony, we have to be doing that. We cannot have two-phase commit because that's a horrible thing to have. It just stalls everybody, it's a blocking protocol. And then Google came up with this landmark paper on Spanner and basically said, your assumptions are all totally wrong. We have done it on a global scale. You can have two-phase commit, you can have synchronous clocks. Deal with it, right? And that completely changed distributed systems thinking. So here, this is a grand merge, and I highly urge you to, how many of you have read the Spanner paper? Right, wonderful. So some of you, I urge you to read this paper. This is just, it's like a landmark paper in distributed systems. This is a way in which you can completely append decades of old thinking. And the idea was that they said, of course we have a global clock, we have GPS. GPS is a source of time, okay? Every GPS satellite has 4 atomic clocks. And when the signal leaves to the time it's received is the time difference that that accounts for the distance because the precise orbit of a particular satellite. And if you take the readings from multiple satellites, you can quintangulate because you're seeing basically 5 satellites. You know your exact spot on Earth, okay, including your altitude. But GPS is basically a source of time. You can infer your location based on that, based on the speed of light and relativistic corrections and all those kinds of things. One of the cool things about their particular clock was that unlike the API that we have for clocks, let's just get time of day, where you get a single number, these guys said, no, you cannot be that precise. You cannot have a single number. That cannot be the consensus in the clock scheme of things. It has to have an error interval. So you'll say the time is 10 o'clock plus or minus 3 milliseconds. Okay? So that error interval is what they try to keep as narrow as possible. So they have GPS receivers in every data center and backup atomic clocks in every data center. And now you have a global synchronous clock because there is a data center in Japan that has the same access to the same time frame as a data center in India and a data center in the US. Okay? And because you have a synchronous clock, your algorithms can become, your timestamps actually mean something. And the wonderful thing about these timestamps is that they're real human timestamps. So you can actually say, give me a snapshot of the database at 10 a.m. And because all the version numbers, you don't need artificial version numbers. You can actually have real timestamps. And the database, you can actually relate versions in a multi-version database system. You can actually relate the versions to real timestamps. The second algorithm that they used was paxos, just like raft. It's the same kind of thing. For replicating nodes, for fault tolerance. And the third thing that they got over, the blocking aspect, I'm out of time, is it? The blocking aspect of two-phase commit was that the coordinator, if it dies, you have a problem, and the database cannot take any independent action of its own. But what if the coordinator was replicated on paxos? Then, you know, there will be another replica which knows exactly what decision was taken because of paxos. So it can drive a transaction to completion. So you have essentially combined a two-phase commit over paxos to make it non-blocking. So that's how you have atomic commit, which is non-blocking. Now it's a proper consensus. Okay? Can I borrow your indulgence for like 5 more minutes to get into Bitcoin? I don't want to explain Bitcoin, but I want to sort of tie Bitcoin to this entire edifice. Yeah? I see some doubtful faces, so please forgive me. Okay. Bitcoin, how many of you here have heard but don't know much about Bitcoin? Okay, good. It's basically a shared log, right? Everybody because it's a financial ledger and you want to avoid double spending, you have to account for event ordering. So if I said I paid you and you paid that person, those events have to come in the same order in everybody's log. Okay, it's exactly like a financial ledger. This is the problem statement, right? The problem is that membership is unknown, but there is an additional problem. Because the nodes are untrustworthy, I cannot rely on node IDs for membership because somebody can just create artificial nodes. I can create any number of IP addresses and claim a bigger membership. So if you do something like a majority voting scheme, I can just create artificial phantom members and swamp any kind of voting scheme. So that is clearly, that's called a Sybil attack. That is not allowed. The network is asynchronous. I actually did not talk about practical Byzantine fault tolerance, but those algorithms don't apply in this particular case because of all these other parameters that are different. Okay, so very, very simply, everyone has a log, and let's assume for the time being that everybody starts off with the same state of their log. It's a shared log. And this guy is a transaction that showed up here and another transaction that showed up here. You broadcast it to everybody. And now whatever everybody has heard of, they batch it into blocks at the receiving nodes. Okay. Now at this point, now the objective here is for the system to converge on the same log. That means whatever they've heard of, the transactions that have appeared into the system as a whole, they must end up at the end of this log in some order. The order does not important, but they must be in the same order everywhere, right? That's the basic safety constraint. They cannot be in different orders everywhere, right? That's the basic safety constraint. So instead of a negotiation phase where you say, okay, which one, like unlike Raft, where you say, where you have a leader, you cannot have a leader because the membership is unknown. How do they come to a decision? So the basic rule is that they have something called a proof of work, where the system is set up such that you solve a very difficult puzzle, let's say, a crypto puzzle, using the last block in the existing log and the first block that's going to go. Okay, you choose a block and you solve some tough puzzle, which everyone agrees is a tough puzzle. Okay, come up with one number, and which is easy to verify that you have indeed solved this puzzle, involving the last bit of the log and involving a particular block. And once you've announced it to everybody else, you gain, you get bragging rights, you get leadership rights, you get to append that particular block to the end of the log. And everybody else follows your suit. Okay? So essentially, this proof of work is equivalent to a spontaneous leadership. Right? Somebody says, I cracked the problem, and for that particular block, he becomes a leader. Okay? And it's completely democratic in the sense that it doesn't matter who did it because it's completely random. Nobody can know a priori because it takes an uncertain amount of time for you to crack this problem. So it's completely democratic. Anybody could be cracking it, right? But whoever cracked it, everybody just accepts it. But it's quite possible that in a system, multiple people might crack it, and one answer is just as good as another. So it's possible now that you have, you know, this system maybe hears from, let's say this guy also cracks it, and or let's say this guy also cracks it, and he has his blocks in a different order. The colors are switched compared to these, right? So he also cracks it and says, I get bragging rights for putting this green colored blob at the end of it. And now who's to win? Now, at this point, it introduces a fork in the log. But randomization is such that it favors the longer chain. So it just so happens that because of emergent effects, one chain tends to get longer, and that is preferred. So the shorter fork is discarded and added back into the pool of pending transactions, and that is retried again. Okay, so everybody can. And so the idea is, the reason why I've shown it in some, it may not be obvious from this, I've shown it in as a gradient. Because just because it's appended to the log does not mean it gets to stay there. Maybe it's still the short end of the chain, and maybe it'll get replaced by somebody else. So just because you've appended to the log does not mean it's pakka yet. It needs to go sufficiently deep into the chain before you can have a reasonable probabilistic guarantee the odds are that it's not going to get bumped out, right? So its emergent consensus is probabilistic, okay? So the farther out the end you are, the less sure you are of that block remaining, okay? So that's basically all I wanted to say. Digital signatures, because you use digital signatures, you can eliminate impersonation. Proof of work renders ID manufacturing useless. So you can manufacture all the IDs you want, it doesn't matter, because the only thing that matters is how much CPU power you have, because that's what allows you to solve the problem. Whether you have 100 IDs or one ID, doesn't matter. And proof of work gives you leadership rights. So this is, without any negotiation at all, right, you are able to spontaneously become a leader, and everybody just follows your example, right? And unlike the last line, unlike typical consensus protocols where there's the back and forth saying, okay, you do this, okay. There's no negotiation, it's just all one-way messaging everywhere. It's a very, very different kind of a consensus protocol, but at the end of it, you have a shared log. That's all I have for today. If it was TLDL means too long, didn't listen. Just shared log abstraction is absolutely important. In particular for Paxos and Raft, these are leader-oriented protocols for efficiency, but just because it's leader-oriented does not mean that you cannot have multiple leaders. When you have multiple leaders, they only stop progress, right? Which is, as we see in real life. But it is safe. Nobody will, you know, the log is still safe. And finally, Bitcoin, there's a random leader for every block, and there's no leadership. That is the leadership, leader election phase equivalent. And randomization is key to skirting impossibility results. Okay? These are the major takeaways that you can have. Thank you. I'll leave it to the organizers to see whether we
can take
should
more
take
questions. We have time for two questions, though.
Okay, yes. We'll take two questions. Okay, who gets to win here? What's the consensus? No, they're all holding back. They don't want to be impolite.
So, in the raft mechanism, you said that leadership part. I mean, is the assumption that we have all the clocks synchronized, and how that leadership happens?
Can you, sorry, I'm sorry, so, I didn't follow.
First thing is there an assumption that all the clocks are synchronized?
Is there an assumption that all the clocks are synchronized? No, it's meant for an asynchronous system.
Okay.
So there are no, let's say there are no clocks.
Okay.
You can time out all you want, Right? You time out, for example, somebody times out and they can announce their leadership, but that is only to make progress. It is not, it does not have any safety implications. So you don't need clocks. You can time out whenever you want and become a leader. I mean, sorry, you can become a candidate. You can only stall progress for a little while, okay? Because you don't need a clock really. You can just say, let me say if I spin around for, let's say, 100,000 cycles of my own processor, regardless of how fast other processor is going, and then I'll wake up and say, okay, I need to interrupt you, I need to stand for election, completely on my own. So there needs to be no clock dependency at all between the two.
And how majority is decided? Because to get that majority, I need to know number of nodes in the...
That's right. So in Paxos, membership has to be known. In Raft, in all these consensus algorithms, the membership has to be known. Now, in the Raft paper, you will see, as with other consensus protocols, there is a definite protocol for changing membership. So if more people want to add, they need to come in a... So that you need to have consensus on the new membership. So if you notice this term view stamped replication or view synchrony, it's all about membership changes. So one view has a certain membership, and there comes a point where you need to transition to a new view, which is a new membership. And that transition is carefully done while existing transactions are happening with the current view. That's carefully orchestrated, and that's built in as part of the protocol.
So the reason I asked for time part is because there are some terms, so I assume that these terms are time bound. And for that, we may need clock.
No, terms have nothing. This is just a logical clock.
Okay.
It is just a number that is incremented monotonically.
Okay.
That's your monotonic increase.
Okay, got it.
So when I get when a follower gets a message from a lower term, right? Some random old leader who thinks he's a leader but is no longer a leader because he's been deposed. But he sends me a message, I'll just ignore it or I'll just knack it. But if I get a message from somebody who's of a higher term, I go max, right? I upgrade my own term. And if I'm a leader, I'll go down to follower. There's your monotonic function right there. Any more questions?
One more question.
Yeah.
Maybe one more question. Anybody?
Well, great. So let's break for some chai. At least I can. Oh, okay.
You talked about proof of work.
Yeah.
Can you also talk about proof of stake a little bit? I've read that a lot.
Yeah. So proof of stake basically means that you need to have instead of anybody being able to come up and say, I solved this problem, you need to have some stake in this thing. So the more money you have, the more stake you have in the system, and the more likely you are to win the race, right? So the amount of stake you have in the system means that there is more, presumably, honesty associated with you. It's in your interest to get it done right. And so you can use this as in conjunction with proof of work. You don't, not in conjunction, but basically your stake determines leadership to some extent. The problem here is that this has a negative feedback loop where if one guy builds up too much stake, then nobody else ever gets a chance. So there are intermediate, there are other algorithms that are just too much to talk about. There is a wonderful free book from Princeton on Bitcoin and all associated cryptocurrencies. Definitely worth a look. And there's a Coursera course also based on this book that they teach. It's definitely worth a look. All right, thank you. And sorry to keep you guys.